So, hi, my name is Karl Babio. I'm working for SUSE, and I will talk about YubiKeys. It will only be a very high-level introduction, and you don't have to hear any deep cryptographic topics or something like that. In case you don't even know what YubiKeys are about, this is a picture of some of them. So, those are the little USB tokens that you can buy and mostly use via USB, although there are also other options. And you can interact with them by pressing a button, and with certain applications, magic will happen. And this talk is about some of this magic. Some stuff about me. So basically, like all of us, I assume, I'm an open source enthusiast. I said work for SUSE, previously as a security engineer, right now in the infrastructure team. So I'm in touch with this YubiKey, and I'm also using it every day in my daily work. I'm nerdy enough to love cryptographic stuff and authentication, IT security, those kind of topics. And I also maintain some of the YubiKey, or with other people, I maintain the YubiKey packages in OpenSUSE, in our SUSE product, and also in Arch Linux. So the agenda for today is something like this. I will talk a little bit about authentication in general, and I will tell you why we actually need something else, but passwords, because passwords have certain kind of problems, and hardware tokens can help with that. And then I will go quickly through the modes that the YubiKey enables. So there are different modes that the YubiKey supports, and I will talk about some of them on a high level. There's a workshop scheduled for tomorrow, where we can go into all of the details and how to actually set this up. But today it's really about, from a user's point of view, how am I supposed to use this in not about the technical details and the configuration aspect, and I also plan for some demo time and Q&A in the end. So, in case you want to read up on this right now or after the talk, there are a bunch of links, most for the users itself. This is probably most interesting to you. It's the website of YubiKey, or YubiCode, that's the vendor of YubiKeys, and they have a lot of resources and explain in very detail what kind of products they have and how different modes actually work. There's also the site toggleoff.info, where you can find out which service providers right now are supporting what kind of tokens. So you can find out where you can actually use those tokens. And there's another page, two-factor, which is doing a similar thing. If you are a developer and you want to find out more on how to develop applications and enable the applications for this kind of stuff, I would recommend those resources for the startup. So, some authentication basics. Basically, everybody every day is doing it without even knowing it. If you see a person and you know him, then you're basically confirming that, yes, this is the person I know. And with computers, it's a little bit more difficult because everybody can sit in front of a computer and claim to be someone else. So, abstractly speaking, it's only the confirmation of an identity, or the process of confirming an identity. This is what Wikipedia is saying about it, but it's very easy to understand, I think. And in our context, when we are speaking about user authentication, then we are answering the question, who am I speaking with? So also other kinds of, so whenever you speak about authentication, there's also this term authorization, and obviously there's a difference to this. So authentication is the question, the answer to the question, who am I? And these are some of the variations that that can be used when you are referring to authentication. And with authorization, we are answering the question, what am I allowed to do? And they are tightly coupled most of the times, but in order to authorize something, you need to know who you are speaking to in the first place. But technically, there's a few different things, and there are also different protocols addressing different aspects of this. And so when you're talking about authentication, there are three things we can use to authenticate someone, and this is something you are. That's the biometric aspects and attributes like fingerprints, faces, face recognition, voice recognition, iris scans, stuff like this, which you probably already know from the smartphone with the fingerprint reading and so on. Then there's something you know, which are basically passwords, pins, and other kinds of secrets. And there can be something that you have that you can carry along. And that's like a physical key, so you can open a door, or also those hardware tokens or smart cards. And in our case, it's a YubiKey, and this is the category of something that you have. those different kinds of things you can combine when you're authenticating someone, and you end up with two-factor authentication, for instance, which probably all of you have heard by now, and in general this is referred to as multi-factor authentication. Whenever you're dealing with authentication, you always have to balance out those three aspects, basically. There's the security aspect, which probably most of the security engineers look at, but at least as important is the usability and deployability. So is it actually usable by normal people, and what are the costs of using and operating this stuff? So a token for the YubiKey, for instance, it's about $50, so obviously there's some cost to it, versus passwords are for free. So there's a lot of authentication protocols. This is just some of them, and they are all addressing different problems and can be put on a different point on this triangle that you just saw. But in the end, basically, there's a lot of options, and there's not one really perfect solution, but there's always some trade-offs that you need to make. And what's actually wrong with passwords? Because there's a lot of stuff that's good about passwords. They're easy to use, easy to implement. They're very universal. You can use them everywhere. It's easy to implement. So in the end, it's only a string comparison. And we have even some recommendation and best practices from the NIST Institute, for instance, which is telling us how long a password is supposed to be, how many characters there should be of different classes, and so on. So on the other hand, passwords are also challenging. And this is also something that you hear all of the time. So people are using weak passwords. They reuse the same passwords. People are being phished, so they enter the password in a place where they are not supposed to enter it. And on the other end, the people that are getting our passwords, they are breached all of the time. They use wrong practices, so they hash them wrongly or not at all. They don't apply solids, stuff like this. They are also very difficult to handle, because obviously we are humans and we cannot remember a lot of random crap, so we need to use password managers or some other schemes, which makes them difficult to handle and also no fun to enter if you have a lot of special characters with different keyboard layouts and stuff like this. It's not a lot of fun to enter them if you have to do it often. And also, even if you have very strong passwords, they do not protect against a lot of attacks that are being done in the real world all the time. So you can still, once you know a password, however you found out, you can reuse it all the time. So this is the kind of replay attack. You can be phished, you can be in the middle, stuff like this. And the reality is basically a mixture of all of what I've just said, so daily breaches with billions of passwords lying around somewhere in the internet, in the dark web. There's a wrong understanding, so for years and years, NIST was recommending that you need to reset your password every 90 days, and basically everybody is doing this because it's also implemented in Active Directories and stuff like this. And even the guy who came up with this at some point said, hey, I'm sorry, this was total crap advice, and it doesn't make a difference. But we are still stuck with it. So there's even some, even among the experts, there's some misunderstanding. And you can also, people are also always arguing, hey, we just need to train people and tell them about it. But actually, there are papers from the 70s and 80s where they are saying, hey, passwords are weak, people are using weak passwords. And after 40 or 45 years of education, we are still having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and password is the most used password in 2017, for instance. So this won't do it. And one way on how to improve this is to use hardware. And this is, for instance, a bunch of different hardware. On the left, you can see YubiKeys, which this talk is about, but there's also a whole bunch of different keys or hardware that is doing a very similar thing. And actually, with U2F and Web of N, this is standard. Those are open standards, and they are cross-compatible, so you can actually use any of those keys for this particular one. And hardware is also used in many different applications and many different other applications, not only in the user authentication on the computer, but also for, like, when you're opening up your car, there's some secret cryptographic going on and with online transactions and so on. And before the YubiKey became famous, basically, it was used a lot in prevalent, there were those hardware tokens that you had physically carry along, and you could press a button or they would just change the key every 30 seconds, like the RSA token or something like this, and you had then to enter this key, this one-time password basically, manually into some field next to the password or something like this. And the YubiKey is, is basically doing a very simple thing. There are also smart cards. They can do a lot of more stuff than just one-time passwords. They can be used to put certificates on there and stuff like this. But in the end, all of this is, the basic idea is that we have a secure environment where we can do cryptography. The keys that are used there cannot be accessed easily or at all, hopefully. It's the CPU or the processor in these tokens, it cannot run any command. It's very closed down. You cannot update it, for instance. And the goal is basically to make it difficult to hack and clone those devices. And the interfaces and so on, they are very slim, and there's not a lot of interaction that you can do. So you cannot do, or hopefully, I'm not able to hack those things. This is the picture you see in the beginning. So a lot of the, it's basically now begins the YubiKey specific part. And they are very intuitive to use. So the only interaction that the YubiKey allows basically is to touch it. And there is a short and a long option. So you can either touch it for, I think, less than half of a second, then it is the short option. And there's another option where you can press it longer and it will use a different slot. But that's it, basically. And it's also very similar, if you want to explain this to your parents, for instance, this is very similar to a physical key. You have to carry it along. When you forget it at home, you cannot log in. But the nice thing about this is that it cannot be easily cloned, and somebody has to physically steal it, for instance, if he wants to pretend to do it. So it requires physical possession. The newer models, they have different interfaces. So USB is probably the easiest one to use, but there's also NFC and Bluetooth Low Energy, and on mobile platforms, those are the most that you want to look into. The YubiKey in general, all of them, they support several different modes, and this allows different use cases. So it's not only this one-time password thing I was talking about, but there's also a Web of N or U2F component here, which is for authentication the web, which I will tell you in a little moment about more about. But there's also like the OpenPGP applet on there, so you can use it as a smart card for GPG. You can use it for static passwords, so you can program in a very complex password, and whenever you press the button, it will just spit out this complex password. And there's also more advanced stuff, like it's called TIF, where you can actually manage identities and certificates on the YubiKey, and it just pretends to be a smart card, just like this, for instance. And with big enterprises, you usually in the past would get such a smart card, and you would have to plug it into your computer, and this will then do some authentication. And the YubiKeys can do the same things, but it's much smaller and much nicer form factor. As you can see, there's a lot of different applications in there, basically. And there's different configuration sets, so actually this is quite a complex device, but for users it's very easy to interact with. So, let's start with one-time passwords. We were already talking about them with the other hardware tokens, and the basic idea behind one-time passwords is that you have a password that is only very short-lived, ideally only, it can be used only once or for a short period of time, and this is used as an additional factor, so you have to provide the actual password, and then you are asked for another one-time password. And there are a lot of different ways you can do this, and different vendors or different service providers choose different routes here. So there are hardware tokens like the RSA one I was talking about. You can have applications on your smartphone. You can use smart cards with the online banking. You get a TAN, which is a little bit more secure, but pretty much the same idea. You can get it via SMS as a text message. Some service providers will send you an email whenever you try to log in, containing some token or one-time password. And of course, you can use the YubiKey, the YubiKey supports several modes for one-time passwords. So the first one is the YubiKey OTP. This one was basically what started the YubiKey. So back in 2007 or so, they created this little device and it would just spit out random crap whenever you press it. And the idea was that it's a USB device, so it will be emulating a keyboard. And you don't need any driver support or anything, it will just type in some letters whenever you press the button. And the service provider, when receiving this string of characters, can then verify the on-hand password. So this looks something like this. If you press it multiple times, it will spit out this random characters. This doesn't have a meaning for us, but actually this is encoded information. So this Ubico refers to it as mod hex. It's not really hex because they also, it's a little bit more complicated because they want to make sure that it's working on all platforms. So they have to, can only use certain key codes and not all characters basically. But in the end, there's information. And what this information contains is, on the one hand, a specific ID for this YubiKey. So basically the prefix or some characters in the beginning are a YubiKey ID. And the other stuff is the actual one-time password, which is encrypted with a password that only the service provider, or in this case even Ubico, knows. And as a service provider, you can ask the Ubico server, because you will send this one-time password to the Ubico server. They also have this key that's burned into your YubiKey, and then they can verify. And there's also a counter for additional protection. The nice thing about this was that it comes pre-configured. You buy this thing from Amazon, put it into your USB slot, and it just works. It's based on a shared secret, and it involves a third party, which is the Ubico. You can host this for yourself, but this is a little bit more complicated, and most people don't choose to do so. So you at least have to, there is some trust relation with Ubico, because you have to trust the result. You let Ubico, so Ubico is doing the verification for you, so you're in the end trusting them. And the nice thing about it is that it scales very well for users, because you can use it with any service provider that supports this, and there's not anything that you need to take into account. You just press the button. In OpenSUSE, for instance, it works out of the box because it's just a USB HIT device. There's an application, it's called YubiKey Manager. You can use this for you can manage some aspects of it and swap these slots, for instance, so you can either choose to do the short press or the long press. And you can also use this with a PAM module, which is called PAM Ubico. You can use this for local authentication. So you can use the YubiKey to authenticate against the system. So in order to log into your system, you not only have to provide a password, but also the right YubiKey. The drawbacks are, unfortunately, that not a lot of service providers pick up on this. There's only a limited number of them. And also this requires network connectivity, so the service provider needs a connection to Ubico in order to verify, and if something breaks it, then authentication doesn't work, which is a really nice attribute of the system. There are other kinds of one-time passwords. These are probably more familiar with. They are usually referred to as OAuth. This is an open alliance for authentication and standardizing on those one-time passwords. There are two kinds of one-time passwords. In this category, they are either time-based, which is DOTP, or HOTP, which is event-based. So basically, you can choose what you want here. It has advantages and disadvantages. The YubiKey, for instance, the event-based one, the HOTP, it works just like before. You press the button and it just spits out this key. With the time one, you need an additional application because the YubiKey itself, it does not have a clock. So you need to have some support from the on the operator, from the host computer, from the host system, which will tell you the time to the YubiKey. Then usually you will just end up with six-digit code. So for instance, if you are familiar with the Google Authenticator or with FreeOTP or something like this, the standard is the same, so all of them will generate the same codes. And then you can enter those codes manually, or with the YubiKey it will do it for you. And this scheme is also based on a shared secret, so this time there is no network connectivity required because the shared secret is on the YubiKey and the service provider has it, so you don't need the third party. But it requires some initial configuration, so before you can use it with any service provider, you have to set it up and share the secret actually. And this is it's easy to do for us, but not for everyone else. And also with these one-time passwords, you can only use it as an additional factor, because you have only the six-digit code, but you don't know who it belongs to. So before you can actually verify it, the user has to provide his username, and ideally also his password already, so you can use it as a second factor, but if someone just gives you this code, then you don't know who it is. With the Ubico OTP before, as I've said in the there's a prefix which will tell you which user it is actually. But here there are no third parties anymore. This you can also use an OpenSUSE. It's working or it's supported out of the box, but as I said, it requires some initial configuration, so we need to configure it. So either the service provider will tell you a secret. Usually they do it via some QR code that you scan with Google Authenticator, for instance, but encoded within this QR code with information that you can also burn into the YubiKey. And once again, with YubiKey Manager, you can configure all of this. And with then YubiCode, you can also use it for local authentication. So once again, you can use this to authenticate against your system. And now you don't need any internet or network connectivity. So you can use this basically without requiring your laptop to have a network connection. But the drawbacks are this initial setup. As I've said, it's very easy for us to do. You copy-paste a string into this application, and the application will burn it into the YubiKey. But for other target audiences, this might not work out. And also, it scales very badly. So technically, I don't want to share the same secret with other service providers, so I would need a shared secret with every service provider. Unfortunately, YubiKey concept only has two slots, so I can at a maximum use this one YubiKey only with two service providers, so you can imagine that this doesn't work out in the internet where you have hundreds of accounts. And on top of that, just in general, this applies to all one-time passwords, there's a bunch of problems, so they increase the security quite a bit actually, where you just simply see and the password doesn't work anymore. And it also has a cool touch to it, so it feels like launching rockets when you have to look up some code or something. But they also don't solve a lot of problems, because in the end, what happens in reality is that people are not only losing their passwords, but they also do other stuff, like putting the password into the wrong web page. And if they fall for this, then they will also enter the one-time password there, and then it can be used by the many individuals, for instance. You can still hijack sessions, like browser sessions or something, if you get a hold of the cookie. And in the end, it's also based on shared secrets, so if the service provider has to store it somewhere, and can use it. So all of this is not really ideal. And the most important thing is that it scales very badly. So as I've said, you will need basically dozens of YubiKeys if you want to do it right. And this obviously doesn't work out. What's more interesting is where they try to do it right is with U2F file 2 and Web of M. Because historically speaking, U2F came first and then the others kind of evolved out of that. And those are now using public key cryptography. And now it begins to get interesting because you will have different keys for different service providers and not the same key anymore. This scales very well for users. So you can use the same key with a whole bunch of service providers and that's not a problem at all. Those standards are mostly focusing on user authentication the web, so it's difficult or not as straightforward to use it for anything other than web authentication. And the vision at least is to get rid of passwords altogether. So it's sometimes also referred to as passwordless time or age. So if you do work with the 502, there are several modes where you don't need any password at all. You just need the key, and that's only. And here the basic idea with all of three of those, because I won't have time to go into the details, is that you have an authenticator, which is the YubiKey in our case. This could in theory also be implemented in software. And also you have support in the browser. And the browser is now talking to the service provider and on the one end, and on the other end it's talking to the authenticator and kind of relaying messages between the two parties. So U2F was developed started in 2012. Now it's technically correct term is the FIDO U2F, because it was donated to this FIDO alliance. And out of all of this came Web of N, and this is in layman's terms, it's the modularization of U2F. So there's this one aspect, the server-to-client communication is happening between the browser and the server. This is Web of N. And then there's this client authenticator communication protocol. This is doing the communication between the browser and the authenticator. And this was split up basically, and all of this together is referred to as FIDO 2. But here we are going to use this synonymously because we don't have time to go into the details and it's a little bit more complicated than this. But with all three of them, you have this terminology. So usually you have the server, which is referred to as relying party. It generates and delivers some JavaScript code. This JavaScript code is then executed by the browser, and it will then basically, this JavaScript code will tell the browser, hey, get in touch with the authenticator. And the authenticator is just an accurate model. It can be implemented in many different ways, but the most straightforward way and one of the more secure ways to do it is the YubiKey. It can also be done in software, where you can then use maybe TPM modules or something like this to make it a little bit more secure, but we are focusing on the hardware tokens here. And basically there are only two kind of ceremonies. So before you can use this with any service provider, you have to register your YubiKey. So somewhere, once you're logged in with using your password these days still, you get into the options and somewhere you can tell them, hey, I want to register a new U2F device, so a new 502 token. And it will ask you, and then it will talk to your browser, and your browser will then ask you to enter your token and press the button. And there's this second ceremony, which is the authentication. And here you already registered previously with the service provider, so the service provider already has your public key, and you can then sign a challenge, that's what's going on behind the scenes, in order to authenticate. This is basically the complex or the technical overview of what's going on with some of the JavaScript API and what arguments are there are, but this is only interesting for developers. For users, the user experience is really easy, so you serve the web just as usually, just as you are used to, and at some point when your browser asks you to touch the button on the YubiKey, you do so. So there's nothing more, basically there's nothing for you to really do besides sticking in the YubiKey and touching the button. All of this is also working in OpenSUSE already, so it actually works with any modern browser, so the Firefox, Chrome, and so on. With Firefox, there's this, in about config, there's this one configuration you might have to enable. I'm not sure what the default is by now. Like a year ago, it was not enabled by default, but as far as I remember, they wanted to enable it at some point. Not sure if they already did so. And with the YubiKey manager, you can actually only turn off or turn on this mode, but you cannot do any more than that. Then this is the list of browsers that are supporting this, and for us, basically, it's Chromium and Firefox. And the nice thing about this was the basic idea, and this was kind of innovative back then, is that there's an individual key pair. So with public key cryptography, you always have key pairs, and you don't want to reuse the same key pair because then you're back basically to the same problem. And with using different key pairs, you are not traceable, and it's a little bit more complicated, but it's using elliptic curve cryptography, so you can use any random bit pattern, actually. So what's going on a high level is you take your device secret, you take your the URL of the website, you hash this together, and this is your key, your private key. And from this, you can derive the public key, which you send to the service provider. And the YubiKey is not saving any of those keys, it can just regenerate them whenever it needs them. So there's not a lot of storage on those YubiKeys, and cryptographically secure storage is expensive. So this is the nice aspect here, it scales well without requiring a lot of storage. And this is this is what's going on cryptographically. But once again, the only interesting thing is that it takes the URL into account and a device-specific secret, which is specific to each device. So every device, every YubiKey you buy, has a different secret burned into it. And therefore, it will generate different private keys and public keys. And you have the web browser in the middle, and the web service in the end, all of them are communicating with each other. And because we have this URL built into the scheme, this is very, so there's phishing protection built in. If the website changes, if you fiddle around with the URL and replace a zero with an O or something like this, stuff that is going on and people fall for, it will no longer work because the hash will be completely different even though it looks very similar for the human eye. And also this scales very well because we don't have to save anything here. You just press the button and in the background the magic is happening with different individual key pairs for each service. And because we have those different individual key pairs, we are also not traceable. So even if I use the same key between different service providers, somebody looking at all of this cannot tell that it's the same UDP key. And the also a nice aspect is that the service provider has only public keys, which are kind of useless. You cannot derive anything from them. Yeah, and then there's another mode in, so another mode, to basically you're switching topics again, and I have to look a little fast about this, I'm sorry, but there's this OpenBGP smart card that you can use. So OpenBGP, probably most of you already know, it's mostly used for email encryption and also for package signing. So when you're downloading packages with Zipper, there's OpenBGP is working in behind the scenes and is verifying the integrity of the packages. But for a lot of people, so you can use the YubiKey for this kind of thing. So you can put your keys on the YubiKey and then use it for encryption. So in order to decrypt any mail, you have to plug in the YubiKey into the computer, and only then the email can be decrypted. That's already nice. But what's even nicer is that you can actually use PGP as an SSH agent, and then you can actually use the YubiKey for SSH authentication. So you can put a SSH and RSA key on the YubiKey, and this can be used for SSH authentication. And all of this is also in OpenSUSE supported out of the box. You only need this GPG2 package, which probably is even installed by default. It requires some special setup. You need to basically enable the SSH agent within GPG, and also you have to set some environment variables. But once this is done, you only need to do this once, and then you can just use your SSH command as you're used to with SSH, and then you can log into systems. And it will actually use the YubiKey. And when you unplug the YubiKey, it will no longer work. And the nice thing about this is that the keys are stored in hardware once again. And when you lose the YubiKey, so basically the smart card, the YubiKey is protected with a pin. So whenever you are using it, you have to unlock it with the pin. And when you lose it or something, then nobody else, it cannot be brute forced, because after three failed attempts, it will block itself and then can only unblock it with a hook. And when you enter this one three times wrongly, then it will just reset itself or block completely, and you cannot reuse it anymore. So it's more secure than just putting your keys on a hard drive and hoping that nobody will ever access it. Because even if it's encrypted on the hard drive, you can still brute force it in this attack. And actually, there are many other use cases, so these were probably the most easy ones to use. So there's this whole PIP aspect to it, but this is more or less only interesting for enterprises, and it's a little bit more complicated to roll out and manage. Then there's also a challenge response mode. This can be used with password managers, for instance, because this shared secret approach is not really working well. You can use it with static passwords, so you're telling the YubiKey to just spit out it's a static password, but it can be very complicated, so you don't have to type it in manually. And you can also use it via Bluetooth and NFC for mobile platforms with Android and iPhones and stuff like this. And if you want to know any more details, tomorrow, as I've said in the very beginning, there will be a workshop where the idea is to set all of this up to what I was talking about here on now. And also, there's a lot of resources on the internet, so basically the developers.ubico.com site, it's a really great portal and a good starting point for any expeditions that you might want to take. And if you're interested more in this U2F pilot and web of N, because this was very high level and I actually simplified it to a degree where it's kind of wrong, but I did a talk at the Chemnitzer Linux-Tag about it, and I go into some of the details in the history. So in summary, passwords by itself are kind of insecure, and YubiKeys are very easy to use and increase the security, so everybody should use them. And the support is quite good in OpenSUSE, so there's no reason to not use it. And now we are coming to the practical aspect of this. There is also on this YubiKey, as I said, this is the YubiKey resources that are available. And for instance, you can validate, so they have a bunch of different demonstration sites, and and applications there. And the easiest one to use is this Yubico OTP. That was the first one I was talking to, and here by personal Yubico for long enough that you just enter those keys. The browser doesn't mean anything, but the service provider can actually decode this on the noise and other information in there. And you can use this to tell if it's the right user, if the user has the right Yubico or not. So this is one thing that you can use here. The more interesting thing and more modern one is the FIDO, the UPN and FIDO stuff. So as I said, with FIDO, UPF, and WebOpN, there are these two steps basically. In the first step, we have to register the YubiKey. So this is where you have to log into the portal of your service provider and you have to tell them about your service key. But this is only a simple view use case, so there's not a lot of fancy other authentication going on. But essentially, you press a button. Now my browser is executing JavaScript here. And now this dialog is coming from the browser, and it's now asking me, telling me, hey, this website wants to use the authenticator. Do you agree? So I can press continue here. And there's because I simplified so much, there is an option to stay anonymous or to actually also set along an attestation certificate, which will tell the service provider what kind of YubiKey I have, which could then in turn be used to track me. So I can either choose to do so or not, doesn't matter here. And now I am asked by the browser to put my finger on the YubiKey. It's also blinking, but this one you can see from back behind. And I just press this button now, and now once again in the background a lot of stuff is going on. And you can check this here. This is all of the information that is exchanged between the browser, the YubiKey, and the service provider. You need to understand something about cryptography in order to make sense of this, but essentially, all of this is sufficient to authenticate myself. This is very easy. You don't have to understand all of this technical stuff. You only press the button, basically. And once I registered my YubiKey, I can also... Okay, there's even more information I can check out here. But the second step is actually to authenticate myself. So I've now registered this device with the service provider. The service provider knows about it, so the next time I come along, I will authenticate, and once again, this is only a demo, so I have to press the next button here. But basically, it looks the very same way. Now I'm not being asked if I want to stay anonymous anymore. I've just been shown this dialog here. I press the button, and I'm successfully authenticated. And this is way easier to use than any password and stuff like this, and it's also way more secure. So this is very nice. And one more thing I can... One more demonstration we can show it. Let's increase the contrast a little bit. And find this one, so we probably... Yeah, so basically I have a bunch of files lying around here, so I can use those are SSH private keys and public keys. And usually, or you probably all know how to use them to authenticate against the server. You can just specify with a -i option on the command line, or you can set up your SSH configuration to use them. What's more advanced is to use the SSH agent. So there is something like this. There's an SSH agent. This is also coming with the OpenSSH package. And if you do something like this here, and now I have an agent running, and you can communicate with this agent with this ssh-add command, and you can now add those identities there. So what you could basically do is to take this key on the hard drive, add it to the agent, and then it can be reused all along, and you don't have to decrypt it all. This is more convenient, but what's even more secure is to use GPG as an SSH agent. So you basically have to get rid of all of this. So I have my setup will set this variable here in a specific way, and in the end I end up talking to the GPG agent instead of the SSH agent, And here you can see with the card number, this is my SSH key lying around on the YubiKey. And now I can use this key just like any other key. I will install it on the server and can use it for authentication. And when I unplug this YubiKey, for instance, I don't see any identities anymore. This is basically more secure than having keys in your home directory. That's pretty much it. And with this I want to open up for questions and answers. Yes,
what? How exactly does it make more secure to get rid of passwords?
The
fact that I know something. So it's more secure to use a YubiKey than a password.
The term secure is obviously difficult, but I would argue for most people it will be more secure to use a YubiKey than to use passwords, because people proved over and over again that they are not able to use passwords correctly. And also,
that's validations for the entropy of passwords, which can
be deployed. So I assume you know a lot about passwords. You're using random passwords for a lot of entropy. But still, you can. There's something when somebody enters your computer, basically somehow gets to know those passwords. He can use them. That's he can use them as often as he wants and so on. So this is not true of the YubiKey. The YubiKey needs to be physically stolen. And I think most people know way better how to secure physical stuff than to secure some information on somewhere on the computer. So that's the main argument. Passwords can be secure to some extent. But for most people, they are not. That's just proven by reality over and over again.
And I understand the question. Can I add a password security for the YubiKey?
Yeah, so this was basically kind of the simplification I did. With U2F, you would not. So this was basically the first step of this. But with now with YubiKey 5 and with 502, there is a PIN just like any other smartphone. But then you can lock your YubiKey basically, and you have to provide this PIN. And if you do it wrongly too often, then it will be not and stuff like that. So that's most kind of a simplification. Yes?
Is it possible to replace the secrets on the hardware?
It depends to which module you're referring to. So to this U2F, Web of N, and 502 one, as far as I don't know, this is really burned into this thing. And with the other stuff, with the one-time password list, you can, with YubiKey Manager, you can set them for yourself and basically, yeah, it will be, the service provider will tell you how to put in the
How can you then know that there's not a copy at Cubico?
That's the one thing you have to trust Cubico about.
But you can just put your own...
Right? I'm not sure, so as far as I know, it's not possible. But there may be other ways which where it is possible. Yes?
What do you do when you lose it?
When you have a problem?
Yeah.
And the answer, basically the 502 answer is to have multiple keys registered with service provider. So you can actually, everywhere where I've registered it, you have somewhere in the menu, you can also tell, you can register multiple devices. But of course it's inconvenient, and I also dislike this aspect of this whole U2F and the program.
Yeah, but if you put your own secret onto the device, then you could have a paper copy somewhere in your safe.
Yeah. I don't build these devices. I don't do anything about it. Any other?
It seems like it's very much vendor locked in because of this dominant position of YubiKey in the setup. So is there any chance that this system can be federated in some sort?
I wouldn't argue that this is vendor locking because there's a lot of other vendors also, and it's an open standard that everybody can implement. So
okay, so that's the question. You just make sure it's from the standard for, like, it's described as much as I was able to make my own YubiKey company, and
so
I was not locked in by the fact that those service providers would need to have this third-party contact with me, which
would also
they wouldn't do because they say 90% of the users are already in YubiKey. So it's like I could, of course, not have a Gmail account, but it's quite hard to have my own SMTP reliably sending stuff out. So there is sort of a vendor lock-in, even though SMTP is an open standard in the sense that there is no inaccessible documentary on how to implement it. Still, I'm locked into certain bigger providers. And so what is your take on that?
Yes.
Dominant position of Yubico?
It also depends kind of the model. When we are talking about 502, then there was this question if I want to stay anonymous or not. If I choose to stay anonymous, the service provider doesn't even know what kind of device I have. They will just be sent a public key and they don't know if it's a YubiKey, if it's done in software or if I have something else. I think Google has their Titan key, which is basically they decided for whatever reason they don't trust Yubico or they don't want to partner with them anymore, so they are building their own key. If you choose to send along this, what happens in the background is you send along a certificate specific to this device, and it is signed by Yubico basically. And the service provider could technically say, hey, I'm only allowing devices from Yubico. So far, I haven't seen anyone doing this, but technically it would be possible. Question answered?
Sort of. I have to give it some more thought to. I can't conceive it as
quickly. Okay, let's discuss afterwards. Yeah, sure. Any other questions? That's it from my side. And let's close it.